Call to order. This is the Monday, November 17th, pre-council meeting for the city of Joliet. Mayor Tom Girani presiding.
Start with roll call. Mayor Girani.
Here.
Councilman Gavin.
Here.
Councilman Girdle.
Here.
Councilman Hug.
Here.
Councilman McFarland.
Here.
Councilman Morris.
Here.
Councilman Boddicker.
Here.
Councilwoman Coleman.
Here.
Here.
Jim.
This evening, we have Kate Knuth here, the general manager of Lewis Joliet Mall, to make a presentation.
Hello. Hi, everybody. I also brought Bob Coys with me, too, from Starwood Development. But I just wanted to come back. It's been a year since I've been here to see all of you, and I just wanted to let you know kind of what we've got going on at the mall. And I appreciate your time. Thank you, members of the City Council. I appreciate it. I've had the privilege of acting as the general manager of Lewis Joliet Mall now for 7 years. And we've got my intention for this evening's, for tonight's review is just to go over a few development projects and investments that have taken place through 2014. Lewis Joliet Mall continues to undergo evolution since the acquisition by Starwood Retail Partners in 2012. Starwood executive teams and regional teams are based in Chicago. We're a full-service shopping center and asset management organization. Starwood Retail Partners is committed to working with retailers, putting them into the right properties at the right time. And this approach allows Starwood to develop highly productive retail environments. We're dedicated to developing strong relationships with our communities as well as our shoppers so that everyone enjoys a positive shopping experience. This past year, we've undertaken aesthetic and functional updates to the mall so our shoppers, guests, retailers, and neighbors can experience and enjoy the highest quality 21st century retail environment. In 2014, the Starwood leasing team has brought game-changing retailers to Lewis Joliet Mall. A first to Joliet and for Will County will be H&M, opening mid-December. In addition to this 24,000 square foot store, the mall team has also managed 9 other build outs or remodels, accounting for a total development footprint of 60,000 square feet, or 21% of the mall's leasable area. Retailers under construction this year include Charlotte Russe, Children's Place, Family Christian Bookstore, Finish Line, McDonald's, Pink, and Victoria's Secret. Auntie Anne's will be opening tomorrow in their new location, while Pandora Jewelry's construction continues until their opening in mid-December. At the close of 2014, the mall will be at 98.6% occupied. A lot of hard work and dedication has gone into making this year one of Lewis Joliet Mall's most productive. In addition, on the topic of construction and development, Lewis Joliet Mall is the first Starwood Center to install a fully interactive digital component. These components are intended to spread throughout the Starwood portfolio of malls, and Lewis Joliet Mall is the initial installation, or the first in the company. Starwood knows that the 21st century is all about technology, and we are thrilled to introduce a platform that will keep our shoppers apprised of mall changes, innovations, new retailers, and community events. If you've been in the mall lately, you may have seen the construction around our center court ficus tree. Lewis Joliet Mall is currently installing digital components in the court that will bring the ficus tree to life. The project is comprised of 2 suspended helixes surrounding our 25-foot ficus tree. From those helixes will hang 113 LCD screens and LED pendants that will function as ornaments and message boards. The digital tree technology lets shoppers and guests engage digitally with the mall and with each other. I'd like to invite all of you to join us as we branch out and share the country's first nature-infused interactive digital tree. Next Wednesday, November 26th, the grand opening celebration begins at 10 a.m. Thank you to the Building Department and Dave Mackley's team for tirelessly reviewing plans and issuing permits in rapid succession. This year, the mall, so far, we're not done yet, has written 46 contracts for service and applied for over 30 building permits. We continue to work with the local trade unions to implement all improvements at a reasonable cost, and we look forward to carrying on the conversation and work into 2015. In closing, I would like you to know that this review is only really the tip of the iceberg. I could take hours telling you about the capital and operational improvements that have been driven and facilitated by the mall this year, but I won't bore you with all of that. I'll just ask you to come to the mall and see it for yourself, because there are only 37 shopping days left until Christmas. So we hope to see you soon. And Christina has the invitations for you guys. Oh, there you go.
Got them.
So, are there any questions?
Thank you, Kate. Great news. Absolutely. 98.6.
98.6, yes.
Great. That would be normal.
I'd like to
know. Normal temp.
Yeah, right. I would say it's not normal for a shopping mall.
No, but I mean, it's great. It's fantastic.
Sure.
So, Kate, when did the Westfield then sell to Starwood? Was that recent?
It was June of 2012.
Okay.
But we were, Starwood at the time of the acquisition wasn't actually managing the property. So as of January 2014, we're managed and owned.
And if I'm not mistaken, Starwood also manages the Promenade in Bowlingville.
Correct.
Well, welcome to Joliet. I don't think I've seen you since. Good work.
Good work. My granddaughters will certainly be delighted that H&M and Charlotte Russe is in town.
Right.
So my purse may not be delighted, but I think that quite excited about those two.
Well, at least start going to pink. Then.
Kate, I just want to thank you and your staff. You're doing a tremendous job in what's still some of the challenging times. And you're keeping it, businesses coming, even as some may have to leave. So you do a great job. It's a great partner to have with the city. And it's a real, you know, what your success is like a real benefit, and it's a real advantage to the citizens, Julia. So I appreciate it.
Thank you. I will see you next, the 26th.
We'll see you then.
Thank you.
Thank you. In review of the agenda for tomorrow evening, first thing we'll have under presentations is an update by Engineering Department leader Lisa Dorothy on the Multimodal Transportation Center to give everybody an update of what's going on. Under the consent agenda, we've got a couple of position vacancies with the recent promotion to deputy chief. We have two vacant lieutenant positions that we're asking to backfill from people that got promoted. Item F under consent agenda is requesting your approval of the renewal of the group health, dental, vision, and life insurance programs. We've had a comparison which we believe is acceptable to the city. This incorporates something a little bit different that was a contractual arrangement whereby employees currently have $10,000 in life insurance, and that can continue into retirement, or at this time they can convert to a $50,000 policy with no retiree benefit.
Questions? Price for this, has it gone up, the insurance?
It always goes up.
I should
restate
that. How much?
You can have your choice.
And our goal 50,000, as staff is to shop around, to do comparisons, to minimize increases, and make sure we're getting comparable coverage. The medical fees do remain flat, and the dental fees did decrease slightly, however. Blue Cross lowered the aggregate stop-loss fee from $31,974 to $15,508, due to our favorable analysis of our actual experience of our members. So that's the good news. There's also a prescription rebate that'll decrease from $2,510 per employee to $2,249. And that's an increase, that's a result of an increased use in the generic drugs.
Any other questions?
Under ordinances, we have, we're amending the agreement with Mavis. Mavis is the Mutual Aid Box Alarm System, which provides assistance to fire departments throughout the state of Illinois. In case we are requested to provide assistance to a adjacent department due to a overwhelming fire or vice versa, we need help from an adjacent community. And the point of this is so that if at a later date, after some kind of emergency that occurs, the federal government declares it a major disaster, then we are eligible for reimbursement of our costs for those expenses that we incur in responding to those.
Questions?
Next item is an amendment to the Emergency Management Agency Ordinance. We referred to it back in 1961 and adopted it as the Joliet Civil Defense Organization. And in 1977, the name of the agency changed to the City of Joliet Emergency Services and Disaster Agency. And so really all we're doing is updating our existing ordinance, adopting that name change so that we can remain eligible for grant funding opportunities through the Illinois Emergency Management Agency and also Federal Emergency Management Agency, which is FEMA. Next item is declaring certain properties public nuisance. We have, I believe, 9 properties. And under bids and contracts, we're requesting approval for the purchase of 2 Horton ambulances for the fire department. The other thing is that we're looking at your approval for a sole source. And the reason for this is because both the fire department, we're creating a standardization from operations. So a firefighter can go from station to station to station, and the ambulance never changes everything. They know how to operate it. They know where everything is on the ambulance. So they're familiar with that. The other thing is also in the fleet maintenance division, the mechanics would be working on one type of ambulance. Pardon me. So they'll be more proficient at the particular repairs that have to be made. They'll have these, they'll be able to limit their spare parts inventory that they have in the garage, which should result in, and we believe, monetary savings to the city, at least in the amount that we're potentially paying in excess. And by that I mean because we're not going to bids on the second page of your backup. We did some comparison of some recent sales, and the department looked at the prices that other communities were being paved to make, were paying, to make sure that the price that they were giving us was not in excess of what other, well, not, it was in the same ballpark, the same range of comparability of what other cities were paid at this point in time.
Sure.
I apologize. If we can go back to the nuisance property.
Sure.
I don't know if anybody here could answer this. Mr. Hale, and I know Mr. Alfredo's on here. 1522 Clement, the old Clark gas station. Clement Theater. What's the status? Did we secure that property? There were some exposed tanks, and they were looting the metal from the pumps. I know some of them were taken out of there, but I just wonder if you give a status tonight or tomorrow.
Dave Mackley and I went out there probably now 60 days ago easily, and what we found is that the vendor that supplied the pumps took them back. So it wasn't like they got stolen. They got actually repossessed, is from what the neighbor next door told us. And that, yes, they did take a couple of the little manhole covers for the storage of the tanks, but I know the complaint at the time was that the tanks were leaking, and that wasn't the case. They still had the covers on the subterranean valves were still covered. It was just those little round manhole covers were removed. The property was secure. There was a for sale sign on the window. Dave did talk to the owner of the property. He is interested in selling the property. So a lot of the things that were of concern from the neighbors were pretty much unfounded. We did find a barrel that had some, like cat litter with some, they must have used it to mop up a fuel spill at one point in time. And once we opened that, that was where a lot of the odor was coming from. But it was in pretty secure shape as of 2 months ago.
The photos that I have from the resident, the ground tanks where they pump in the fuel, they were exposed. And if you did go over them, I think Mr. Hock and I went over there, I smelled fumes of gasoline. Also, when we brought this up, the actual pumps were being stripped for metal.
Yeah.
Again, the photo showed it. So I don't know if between when we were there, the neighbor was there, and you were there, it looks horrible. And
right.
I think the city needs to file some type of legal action to get it moving, to either condemn the property or to have it cleaned up, because it looks no better than it was 2 months ago than it is today.
And this is the start of that process. But Dave has had a discussion with the owner, I believe, at the number that was listed on the for sale, and he gave him the instructions to clean it up. And I think this is a result of frustration where that wasn't done.
Thank you.
Anything else? John?
Here it is. Since we're talking about the problem properties that Councilman McFarland brought up, I've actually been dealing with one in my district. Mr. Hockman, I'd like you to take a look at it.
Yeah, you raised that on there.
We've been looking at it, but it's in the Twin Oaks subdivision, 3019 Twin Oaks Drive, section of the Twin Oaks subdivision. And basically what's happened is that the previous owners of the property basically left it in abandoned, left it in pretty bad shape as far as the outside. And I know that city staff as far as they went out there and cut the grass, did some trimming, because it was really an eyesore to the neighbors. And I've driven by there a number of times, and they did clean it up. However, a couple weeks ago, and my understanding is that I believe the property is now in foreclosure, so I think it's in Kansas. But a couple of weeks ago, there was a party there at this house. Some kids, got into the house, and obviously caused a disturbance to the neighbors and that sort of thing. So I guess if I could get maybe tomorrow an update on where this is at, maybe we could contact the bank, see what their plans are. See if there's any city remedies that we could also pursue, but really just get an update so we can forward this on to the neighbors and let them know what the status of this property is and what their plans are. So if you could give an update.
We'll be sure to do that.
Chief Formals, I was curious. I was noticing in our comparisons, a couple of them have something called a power cot and lift or and load. Is that something we should be looking at investing?
We currently have a power cot. We bought those, I think it was 2012. We invested in a 50-50 split, the foreign fire.
Your microphone's on, Chief.
Oh, there we go. I believe it was back in 2012. We did a 50-50 split with the foreign fire tax. They purchased half of the cots, we purchased half. I think it was right around $110,000 purchase. So we do have power cots in all the vehicles right now, the frontline vehicles. We do not have power cot and load. We don't have the load in there. That's where it actually comes out and picks up the cot and pulls it in. To be honest with you, I think the power cots are doing what we hope they would, cut down on some of the back injuries. I think for the extra money, I think we're good with just the power cuts personally.
Power cuts?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. I have another question. Oh, I'm just going back yet to the EMA. Jim, will it be changing the structure? Will our EMA director still be, I believe it's Mark, is it Mark Seven?
Greg, yes.
Will he remain as the EMA?
Yes.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Most of the other items are amendments, change orders, payments that have been reviewed by the Public Service Committee. If there are any questions on any of those. It's a brief agenda tomorrow night.
Yes. Citizen to be heard. Robert Webb. Is he here? I don't see him. Richard Martin.
Here.
Yes. You want to speak?
Yes.
Step up to the mic.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
I'm here today because I was violated at Ranch Liquor Store. I was inside the store, to make a long story short, because I'm sick and I don't feel good, forgive me. And I was, before I was waited on, Mary Jones Brown come in the store and we were having a conversation and speaking. So the gentleman, Mo, that managed the store or owned the store, I don't know, he told us to be quiet or exit his store, basically, and that we need to go back to Africa. And in the process of that, we exchanged a few words, so did Mary, I guess, with him also. So I guess we wasn't moving fast enough. And in the process of us leaving the store, he spit on Mary Jones Brown. And he pushed me with his hand in my back and pushed me out the store. She went to file a report that night. I didn't. I was just basically brushing it off. But I realized that that was wrong. It was disrespectful. It was a violation. And I know my human rights don't run out, but regardless of that, I want to file a complaint, and I would like for Ranch Liquor to be closed, because I have come in the store several times and witnessed him telling African Americans that they need to go back to Africa.
Hey, ma'am, that is a police issue. I would suggest that you meet with Deputy Chief Gregory or Detective Matlack. They're both here, so
okay.
Maybe go back and talk to them.
I sure will.
Okay.
And thank you all.
Sure. Rosie Tyler Lewis.
Hi, Mayor and all.
Hi.
Yes. On the 8th month to 23rd day, I was taking care of some business and I missed the bus, so I went on and walked home. So my sugar had started bothering me, so I ran in the store to get something to calm my sugar till I make it home. While I was in the store, he was fussing at this black guy. He was coming in the store. He made him get out of his store. So after he got through hollering at him, I purchased what I was buying, and when I purchased what I was buying, Jack said, I hate y'all look like monkeys to me. And I looked at him, because I couldn't believe he was doing it, the one over there laughing. And I couldn't believe he was doing it, so I say, I went and called 911. So 911 said they couldn't do nothing about it because that was his store. So I said, okay. So after that, I left. So as I was walking down the street, the police came by. He said a racist word. I'm going on, I can change my life. 12 years, I ain't got in no trouble. I don't bother nobody. I don't want them bothering me.
Excuse me, is this the is this in the human relations courts right now? Is this the one that's in the human relations in court?
What you mean?
Just a lawsuit.
Yeah, I put in a lawsuit against him because...
Right, before you talk anymore,
okay.
John, you want to address that? John is the attorney for the my office, the liquor commissioner's office.
You tell
John, you want to address that?
Sure. Okay. So you're speaking to the microphone. John Y., Assistant Corporation Counsel. Mr. Mayor, there's currently pending before the Department of Human Rights, the Illinois Human Rights Commission, a complaint that was filed by this individual against the owner of the liquor establishment at 83 West Jefferson Street. It is currently pending. There was a restraining order filed today that was denied by the Bull County Court judge. However, at the current time, the complaint's pending. A hearing has been scheduled. I believe it's up Thursday. Ms. Lewis is represented by counsel, and that counsel filed to have a continuation of that hearing. Or that's pending before the Human Rights Commission. And also, the owner of the establishment's here with his counsel today, and I believe they would like a chance to briefly rebut any statements made. In addition, the counsel should be aware that after the last council meeting, and I believe there's a couple council meetings before that, similar allegations had been made. The mayor and Ms. Gavin also met with the owner to ask him about the allegations and do some investigation, as well as the police department's investigated some of the allegations that have been brought before this council. Discussions were had with the owner of the business. We do understand that the human rights case is pending, but the mayor and Ms. Gammon did meet with the owner, discuss those allegations, as well as the police department's also investigated allegations, not by this individual perhaps, but by others who have come before the council in relation to a weapon or being afraid of a weapon being at the business.
Mayor, one question.
Sure.
John, when was the human rights case filed?
That was filed in January of 2014. I believe the allegation is that these comments were made in August of 2013.
No, about in the eighth month, about the 26th or 27th, I called him in and told him.
Do you want to address where you're at with that?
I would like to, if I may.
Sure.
Step up to the microphone.
Sure. Good evening. I want to thank you for the opportunity to address these issues. My name is Chris Rowski. I'm an attorney in Joliet, and I represent Jack Basher and Basher & Sons Corporation, which is doing business as Ranch Liquors. We've heard these allegations before. They changed, and they're different every time we've heard them. My client has denied them unequivocally. This evening, I heard Ms. Lewis indicate that now it's supposed to be Mr. Basher who made these comments. In her complaint and before the commission, she earlier attributed these comments to an individual in our store named Mo. I can tell you that we deny these allegations. We believe that it's more or less an effort to extort money from the business. We would never condone, nor would we ever participate in any of the conduct that's been complained of. And we believe that we'll be exonerated when it comes before the Human Rights Commission. I can tell the court that the initial accusations were against an individual named Mohammed. He was present at the Liquor Commission hearing. At that time, Ms. Lewis indicated he was the individual who had made the comments. And Mr. Mohammed was not even working at the business on the dates that she said that these incidences occurred. His office hours terminate at noon each day, or his business hours terminate at noon each day. And on the particular date in question, she's alleged this to have occurred, was August 23rd at 7:33 p.m.
No, it was the 8th month.
Wow. I'm just going.
23rd.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Nobody interrupt you.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
But, and Your Honor, what we were able to determine is that on August 23rd, at the time she alleged these occurred, again, the individual was not even present. We believe that this is an effort, and this is something that has to be determined by the Human Rights Commission, but we believe this is an effort by certain individuals to try to extort money from our client. We've never had any problems or complaints before. We've had a couple of them recently. These complaints come from people who live in close proximity to each other. I think two of the complainants are at the same address. We've been accused of brandishing a weapon. Mr. Muhammad was accused of that, unless it's going to be changed to Mr. Basher today. But Mr. Muhammad does not have an FOID card, doesn't have a gun, does have a colostomy bag at his side, but never brandished a weapon. On the date that those allegations were made, the individual in the store had ducked behind the counter in an area where he wasn't authorized to be. And then we did approach him, and we were shook up because we were fearful of his suspicious conduct. And we essentially advised him that what's he doing? That's dangerous to do that. And my client indicates that Muhammad did say to him, "You could have been shot." We don't have a gun. We never did have a gun in the store. Mr. Basher doesn't allow a gun in the store. But that's the extent of any altercation with that individual. And again, Ms. Lewis is free to make her allegations, but we vehemently deny each one, and we believe we'll be exonerated at the hearing. Thank you.
Chief, would you give a report on what's happening with the investigation into these allegations?
Yes, Mayor. As we know, over the past few weeks, we've had a couple of incidents that have been highlighted here, one of which I had addressed in a past meeting. There was an allegation that I didn't review all of the reports that would have occurred at this store, and I have to admit that's correct. I look back for the past year to look for any similar reports. It just so happened that the allegations that we're talking about now had happened even farther back, in August of 2013. So at the time, we assigned the reports for follow-up through our investigations. Detective Matlock, who's here today, had documented reports of repeated attempts to contact the victims in those offenses and was not successful. But since then, we've resurrected the issue a few weeks back to try to investigate it again before the statute of limitation runs out. At this point, there doesn't appear to be probable cause for the arrest for any of the offenses that are alleged, and we have done as much as we can to investigate them thoroughly. That the delay in the time they were actually reported from the time they occurred is a problem here for us to prove a case.
Thank you. It's in the correct statement is courts, Human Rights Commission. So whatever however that works out. Okay.
They lying.
Well, it's your word against theirs.
No, it's not my word against. If it's another boy, I can get in here. I just got to find where he living at.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Do we need?
I have a request for closed session, Mayor.
Okay. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Krista? She's going to read it.
Cover motion for me to go into closed session to discuss personnel, collective bargaining, land acquisition, conveyance, tenure, growth, and location of the attorney, Mr. Gavin.
Aye.
Councilman Burrell?
Aye.
Councilman Tuck?
Aye.
Councilman Carlin?
Aye.
Councilman Morris?
Aye.
Councilman Hooker?
Aye.
Councilman Turk?
Aye.
Mayor
Aye.